Peace, y'all. It's Godson. First thing in the morning. I'm going to let y'all know right now, this is going to be the most realest, most honest, the most truthful, the most clairvoyant piece that I do. This is going to be it right here. And I'm going to come fully from the heart. Because I've been made aware of some things throughout the course of my whole life. And a lot of it's about to come to fruition. And I'm really just making this video for myself. I was meditating yesterday and I had a whole lot of things just starts coming up, you know, and I got really emotional. And you know, I'm just making this video to just be true, because it's something that needs to be done as I move into a higher realm of being, in a higher state of being. And so all the old layers must be shed. And I'm only going to speak on these things one time. So in the future, I'm just going to refer you back to this video. If you have any questions about my past life. And once again, I'm dealing on that God-Son wave. That's what I am. That's what I am. Whatever I attach to my name, whatever I attach to my I am, I must and I will become. I am that I am. Which is why I've embodied so many different frequencies and so many different names throughout my life. Because names are equating to the energy. For example, I've gone by the name of balance. Because I was in that state where I needed balance. I needed to be Ma'at. And I still am balanced. I've gone by the name of love because I wanted to vibrate at the highest state of being, love. If I attach my name to that, then that is what I must become. That is what I must embody. That is what I must display. I've gone by the name of I am. Somebody asked me, what is your name? I say, I am, because I am. And my name, the name cannot be boxed. That's the issue with names, is that a lot of these names, they're boxing energy and they're boxing you within your egoic self. And so I constantly have switched my energy. I've gone by the name of just simply Asar. I've gone by the name of Phoenix, the resurrected one. Because these are just different levels and different energies that I've been working with on my own personal journey. But I want to take y'all all the way back. I want to take myself all the way back, because this is a document. This is just a file. And, you know, I'm just going to be very, very honest, very open. Like I said, very transparent. Because I have a story that needs to be told and will be told. And I truly feel that this will help millions and millions and millions of people, billions of people on their own personal journey, on their own personal path, to follow and stay true to themselves, regardless of circumstance and situation. And when we're dealing with an individual, for example, you know, people forget, because people are going to see me. Remember, I'm teaching you all the videos that I posted. I'm not going to be here forever. Like I told you, I'm going to be here forever in spirit and soul, but this physical vessel won't be here forever. So I'm leaving all this material behind for my children and my children's children and my children's children's children. And when I say children, I'm talking about all the beings that are part of my soul, that are part of my soul group. Because even the Christ said, I said, Who is my father? Who is my mother? Surely it is ye who do the will of the Father who is the mother. And by that, what I'm saying, and what the Christ figure, because the Christ is a level of consciousness that we all should be attaining to. So we all should see ourselves at some point or another as the Christ, as the Messiah, as that level of conscious awareness of who and what we truly are. So what was being said is that your earthly mother, father, brother, sister, they are not your true father, mother, brother, and sister unless they are doing the work of the Father, meaning the work of the higher self. He said, these are my brothers and my sisters, pointing to the apostles, because they are one with what I am doing. We are on the same path. We are on the same path to salvation. And remember, salvation is not something that comes from without. You are to create your own salvation through living a life of virtue and righteousness. Righteousness does not mean and equate to holiness. The indoctrination has misled so many beings into looking at being pious, being restricted, as being holy or being something to aspire to. Being righteous and holy are two completely separate things. And that's not what I'm here to get into. I'm here to get into myself and being open. And so, like I always do, I like to incorporate the music. I want to set a mood. I want to set the ambiance. And I'm just going to let you know who the Godson really is and how I came to be at this point. Because like I said, people always look at the end result. Oh, wow, look at what he's doing. He must have been on doing some black magic and witchcraft and this and that. Because remember, people fear what they don't understand. They hate what they can't conquer. And they've never been able to conquer this mind. And a being will naturally fear what they don't understand. So then they'll always attribute it to something else because they can't see themselves in that same light. Listen, you will never walk my steps, so don't try. Don't try to walk my steps. Just look at my blueprint. Look at the blueprint and walk your own path. Because like I told you, you're going to get to exactly where you've imagined yourself going. The most beautiful place, the most beautiful scenery, the most beautiful beings is what you are going to see and become. It's all part of the journey. And so I'm just here to share that with you. So I'm going to start with a little bit of music. This is a beautiful song too. Please accept me for who I am, and please accept me for what I do. I'm just doing everything that I can, and all I wanna be is true. So please accept me for who I am, and please accept me for what I do. I'm just doing me without you, all I wanna be is true. All I wanna be is true. Apologies if I ever let you down.
it's hard to talk about. So many lawsuits that my lawyer said don't talk about. Just had to pray, keep it cool till I can walk about it. Came home and my sister raised a child. Kinda hurt me cause I could have my own now. I lost my baby and it's really getting home now. I just had to learn. This is me.
So please accept me for who I am. And please accept me for what I do. I'm doing everything that I can. And all I wanna be is true. So please accept me for who I am. And please accept me for what I do. Cause there's no me without you. And all I wanna be is true. So please accept me for who I am. And please accept me for what I do. Doing everything that I can. All I wanna be is true. Please accept me for who I am. And please accept me for what I do. Cause there's no me without you. And all I wanna be is true.
Alright, and all I wanna be is true. And all I wanna be is true. Alright,
and all I wanna be is true.
You see, in this society, we are not encouraged to show our emotions, to show our true selves, to show our true feelings, so we keep it bottled up. We keep it bottled up. And as men, we've been led to believe that it's weak to show emotion, it's weak to cry. But in actuality, it's the exact opposite. That's the mark of a true man. That's the mark of a true being who is highly evolved, because the most highest of evolution is feminine evolution, and then the androgyny, meaning then the combination of masculine and feminine principles. This has nothing to do with sexual orientation. I'm dealing on an energetic level. So if you can't shed a tear, if you can't display emotion, if you can't have feeling, then that just means that you're blocked up. And for the longest time, I experienced that. And I'm just now being able to let things out, let things go, express myself, and speak on things that I lodged way back. You see, this right here is a form of age regression therapy as well. Because by speaking about it this one time, I'm releasing it, I'm taking it out of the subconscious, and I'm just basically deleting these files. Because I'm moving forward. I am God's son. I'm moving into a whole different light, a whole different darkness. I'm creating my own light. Remember, out of darkness comes the light. You see, so I'm going through my own transition. And this is a necessary thing for me to do at this time. And so, you know, I just wanted to just start by saying that you know, when I was young, a young boy, you know, my dad used to tell me, he said, son, you're here for a big reason. You're going to influence millions of people. I've seen it in my visions. You see, my dad's from a small tribe, a small place in Africa, in Kenya to be exact. And he's from the Luo tribe. And, you know, you can look up the Luo origin of civilization, Google it. Even the archetype Barack Obama, you know, his father's from the Luo tribe as well. These are some of the first people to walk the face of the earth. You know, and my dad, you know, he is a master manifester. That's why I tell you I'm God's son, S-O-N and S-U-N. Because my earthly dad is God as well. That's God in body. That's the original man. That's the blue black. That's the original. That's the O negative blood type. Remember, the O negative blood type does not even have its origin here. You're dealing with a star being. You see? And, you know, he manifested things when he wasn't even consciously aware of it. Listen to this. When he was about 8, he told me the story about how there was a car in the village at this time. I forgot exactly what it's called. It's called a paguet or something, but it was considered to be, you know, that fly shit at the time, you know. And he would walk around the village and he would tell all of the people in the village, my dad has a white one of these cars. He got a white one. He drives a white one. Now, mind you, he didn't have that. My grandfather at that time did not have that. But my dad kept saying it over and over, kept saying it. All of a sudden, he goes home one day and that car is parked right in the driveway. Somebody had went and bought that car for my grandfather without my dad even being aware of that happening. He was just speaking it. He spoke into existence. He said, I'm going to go from this little tiny village and I'm going to go to the United States. I'm going to play soccer. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to get a scholarship. I'm going to be successful. See, the term successful is based off of the level of cognition or the level of conscious awareness at the time. So he was dealing in terms of the world's success. And for a boy who has nobody to look to who's doing these things, that right there is brilliant in itself. And he's done all of that and more. And so he told me when I was young, he said, you're going to influence millions. Be prepared. Be prepared. And I always felt it in myself that I had special gifts in so many different areas. But I was very scared. I operated from fear because it was a lot to think about, especially once the ego started to set in. So, you know, I grew up in a place called Santa Barbara, and you know, it's a place where it's a smaller kind of community, and you have a little bit more flexibility in terms to grow because of the environment. You know, it's close to the beach, close to the mountains, and anytime you're close to beaches and mountains, what you're gonna have and what you're gonna see is it's gonna be a high energetic vortex. Now, you know, I grew up playing basketball. That was the first thing that I always loved to do. I literally loved playing basketball. I played for the Oxnard Rebels. I played for this team called 805, you know, and I'm bringing all that stuff back. I'm going to bring it all back. But those were some of the greatest memories of my early years, playing basketball, doing all this, going to these tournaments, going to Palm Springs. That's why I always like to listen to, like I told you, I go back in time with the music. I listen to a lot of Ja Rule and Ashanti, a lot of songs from like 2003, 2002, you know, those were times when, you know, we were going to these tournaments in Palm Springs and Las Vegas and just having fun. We have the big white van, you know, shout out Steve and just all the people who helped along this path and along this way. And, you know, so, you know, those were great times. And I really was excelling because I hadn't developed an ego yet. I hadn't developed an ego. I was just operating directly out of my subconscious. So everything was coming naturally. Everything was coming easily to me, in terms of basketball, in terms of just life. I didn't think. That's why it's so said to return to a childlike state where you're not thinking, nor are you reacting. Because a reaction has to come from outside. You're just doing. You're living from within and you're projecting out everything. That's living in heaven. And so I was living in that space. And it wasn't until around 12 or 13 that I started really realizing certain things about the environment and the world outside of my little bubble that I was living in. And after sixth grade, you see, I grew up, all of my friends growing up, the school that I went to from K to six was all white and Latino, and all of my friends were white kids, you know. Those were my best friends. Jeremy, you know, was a great friend. You know, we always hung out, we always played games together, and we just had a great time, because at that time we were just kids. So all we saw was energy. Once again, I like your energy, you like mine, we high energy, you know what I mean. We're the shit, you know. We're gonna take over the world, you know what I mean. We love being active and running around and just being wild, you know what I'm saying. Like, it makes me think of what's his name, whoever that announcer is, when somebody dunks on a motherfucker, he said he has no regard for human life. He has no regard for human life. That's how we lived as little kids. And not in a negative sense, but we didn't give a fuck. And once again, I'm just going to speak from my heart. So if I, you know, offend anybody, so be it. This is for myself. But we didn't give a fuck. We just lived and had a great time doing it. I remember going to his house and we'd be jumping off of his roof. Like, he's like, yo, you ever jumped off of roofs? I'm like, no. He's like, come on. We hop on the roof and we just start jumping off of the roof, like pretending that we're flying, you know. And those were the type of things we'd do. We'd just go on like adventures, and just create imaginary worlds, basically, you know. And so it wasn't until I made that transition, because prior it was only two black people or melanated beings in that entire school, K through six, me and Ariel. That was it. Now, it wasn't until I reached about seventh grade when I started really realizing and my eyes started being opened up to race, to class, to social status, to all these false constructs that are part of the matrix system. Okay? And the way that worked out was, you know, after sixth grade, it was about making a transition. Obviously, you transition from elementary school to a junior high school. And so I made that transition, and I was supposed to go to Santa Barbara Junior High, which is just another public school. And I ended up, there's a school called Laguna Blanca, a very prestigious, expensive school at the time. It's probably more now, but I think it was about, just for like a seventh grader, eighth grader, it was close to $20,000 a year for tuition, you know what I mean. You know, they're sending a lot of these kids to these Ivy League schools, and you know, it's basically a preparatory school. When we're dealing with preparatory schools, we're dealing with preparation schools that the so-called elite, which no longer exists. Like I said, I am the 1%. I am the elect. I am the chosen. I am the elite. Once again, I am biologically connected to this earth. I am the illuminated one. You know, I do have the power of the Merkaba, of the light body, you know. But in terms of dealing with the old world, that's what I'm here to discuss right now. But, you know, the so-called elite, they will send their kids to these preparatory schools and they receive a special type of education or a special type of indoctrination to help them stay in positions of power, because we're dealing with bloodlines, genealogies, and we're dealing with keeping the resources in the hands of the beings who have been controlling it over the course of the years in dealing with linear time. Remember, this all is illusory. Linear time is illusory. The only thing that truly exists is circular time. Ages. Yugas. But let's stick to the point here. So, it was recommended that I take some tests, some standardized tests, to apply for a scholarship to go to this school, because this school was so damn. It was this wall right here. Remove these two things. It was this wall. You see what I'm saying? White. Pasty. You know what I mean? It didn't have any kind of flavor to it. Straight vanilla. So what they were trying to do at the time was to get some more, how should I say this? Some more minorities. I don't even like to use that word because I'm the majority, you know. The melanated being is the majority of the earth. See, I'm just going to speak all facts. Once again, whoever don't like it, you know what I mean? That's that escape button right there. You got your mouse? Boom. Click that back. Okay? But Europeans make up, you know, less than, what, 6%, 5% of the global population? So when we're talking about minorities and all this type of stuff, these are just code words to, you know, it's power plays, you know. So let's just say more disadvantaged. More disadvantaged youth. And I don't want to make it seem like I came from just pure poverty and none of that. I came from a middle class, lower middle class, I would say. Parents were divorced when I was 3. You know, my mom worked retail and my dad worked for the county. You know, so it's not like we were homeless living out on the street. You know, I still was able, I'm an only child. You know, I was still able to get all the things I was always provided for. I always had new clothes and shoes and things like that. But in terms of disadvantage, in terms of the way that somebody who's making 10, 20, working for Fortune 100 companies, CEOs and executives send their kids to these schools, I'd be considered disadvantaged. Okay, so they wanted to bring more melanin, more pigmentation into the school, and they wanted to bring more kids that were in a disadvantaged state into the school. So I was a prime candidate for that. So first I had to take some tests and things like that. Boom, I took the test. And these tests weren't really the standardized tests. They were tests to see, basically, I remember some of the questions were like based off of how I thought, my thought patterns, my visions, basically, like my creative abilities. Because remember, we're dealing with getting certain children that have exemplary qualities and molding them. Like I said, I'm Barack Obama. I'm Obama. Same bloodline. Luo father, white mother. But check this out. And this is no knock, but this is just real. I'm Obama. Had Obama buck the system. Obama's the product of Zbigniew Brzezinski. Obama's the product of a mold. That's a created being that was created to fit into a specific place and to be used as a puppet on a string. if I would have followed that path that was laid out for me, I would be in a completely different space. But I wouldn't be God's son. I wouldn't have reached this state of cognition. I wouldn't have reached the state that you see me at now. You see, this is, I'm recording this video on March 14th, 2017. You're watching this later, and you're seeing everything that I've spoken on come to fruition. Like, I am the greatest athlete of all time, because I spoke that to be. You know, so that's what we're dealing with. So I took these tests because what essentially was supposed to happen, if I didn't have a strong mind and buck a system and just say, no, I'm going to follow my own path, I'm gonna blaze my own trail, I would have been, you know, corporate. So I took the test, passed, you know, and boom, got that scholarship, and I went there for that 1 year. That was when I first started having experiences and with race, with class, you know. Like, I remember my mom, she had an old 89 Camry, right? And it was white, and it had like rust on the side of it and all this, and when she hit the brakes, it would screech. It was screech, and I was really embarrassed because all the other kids, it used to be like a running joke, like all the other kids would get dropped off in S500 Benzes, always silver. Like, we talking about some real, like, copy paste ABC square type of lifestyle. I remember there was a kid named Andy who I got invited over to his house, and he had a nice ass house in a area called Hope Ranch. And they were like, you know, I wanted to go over there and play or whatever. And they told me, like, yo, you can't walk on the lawn. They got a big ass lawn. You can't walk on the lawn. That shit was prime and plush. And like, you can't walk on the lawn. Take off your shoes. Do this, do that. And it was like, damn, y'all are just so like, where's the life? No music, no just, it's like you got all this material, but there's no life here, there's no spirit, there's no happiness. You know, I started seeing these type of things, and then I started seeing they were all getting dropped off in Benzes and Bentleys and, like, you know, all this type of stuff, and I'm like, damn. And I remember I put my head down before I got out of the car because I was so embarrassed, like, because I didn't realize, I didn't understand, like, yo, why don't we have these things? You know, why are we living in this little tiny place and then this kid got this big ass mansion? Why? Why is that? Is there something wrong with me? And then I started realizing race relations on picture day. I used to like to skateboard. You know what I mean? I like to skateboard. I like to bike. I like to get on my bike and ride around on my bike. I used to have this big ass helmet, like almost it was like a BMX racer helmet, big ass helmet, looking like some Star Wars. And it had the thing on the top so you couldn't even see my eyes. And then on the mask was like one of them joints where it's like Hannibal Lecter looking. And I ride around on my bike all through everywhere, and my BMX bike. But then I also skateboarded too. And I had a shorty sweatshirt, like I used to wear, like shorties, Osiris. It's funny, I was already on that Osirian energy back then. I remember my favorite pair of shoes, and I'm going to get another pair of these. Let me write this down because I got to get another pair of these. Osiris shoes. So I was already on that Osirian energy. And, you know, I went to picture day. This is when I first had gone to this school. I was 12, 13 years old. And it was picture day, and I wore my shorty shirt. And a kid said, what are you doing wearing that? You can't wear that. Black people don't wear that shit. And that was when it first, like, started hitting me, like, damn, like, what you mean? Like, I can't wear this shirt. What am I supposed to wear? So that's when I started having issues with identity and being like, damn, well, you know, my mom is white with red hair. My dad's from Kenya. You know what I mean? Like, there was no place for me to specifically fit into. I didn't necessarily identify with any specific group at that time, because I was eclectic. I was something new, you know, so I just did as I do. You know, I was one of one. I still am one of one, you know, but I wore that shirt. So he's like, yo, black kids can't wear that. And that really just hit me like on a deeper level. And that's when I started really just like getting on some looking to outside of myself, like, well, who should I be like then? And that's when I started listening to a lot of a lot more hip hop, a lot more rap. I remember the first album that I had was that Drew Hill Enter the Dragon or Unleash the Dragon. No, I think it was called Enter the Dragon. It was with that How Deep Is Your Love For Me? Tell me what it's gonna be. And do you see yourself fucking with a nigga like me on the low? Don't see a friend, so no, see now. How deep is your love for me? And I used to just put that on my CD player and just listen to it all day. And then I got TQ. They Never Saw Me Coming. Listen, that's a jewel. That's one of the most classic albums. And Brandon used to hate when I play that album, but that's the realest album. TQ, They Never Saw Me Coming. They Never Saw Me Coming. And I remember it was the unedited version. Like, this is how much of a childlike mind I have. I almost wanted to throw it away, that and the Drew Hill album, because there was bad words on it, you know? Like, I was real, like, you know, innocent-minded at that time. I remember being, like, in 7th, 8th grade, and a lot of the kids, like, over there, these kids were... They didn't have supervision. They had nannies and all this extra stuff, and they moms were on prescription pills, so they'd be getting pills in 7th grade and smoking weed and doing all kinds of stuff that I was playing basketball, you know. I was living a more sheltered, structured kind of lifestyle in terms of that, you know. And I was the only child. I spent a lot of time with my dad and with a couple little friends from my team, you know. So I wasn't wilding out like that. And they were like, yo, you don't be watching porn and all this type of stuff, like, you know, these in 7th grade, that wasn't on my radar like that, you know. I was like really just a kid. I didn't even mess with girls. I was like, I love playing basketball, video games and basketball, eating pizza, Rusty's Pizza. That's it. That was what my constituted everything to me. And so, like, once I started realizing that, that's when I started listening. I remember then after that, the next albums I started getting, I got 400 Degrees by Juvenile. My mom got me that, and then got me the Eminem. I think it was the Marshall Mathers LP. That's the second album. So I started listening to that music. I started switching my style up. I remember I got there was a website called GangstaGold.com. You know, and I remember I got one gold tooth. I got one gold tooth. And put it right here. And I just go to school with one gold tooth. I go to school with one gold tooth in my mouth. And, you know, my uncle lived in San Diego at the time. And we go out there and visit him. And there was a spot in, I want to say like East San Diego. It was like a hood spot out there. And it was kind of like the Sloss and Swap Meet. But in San Diego, and we went out there, and I'd get like all kinds of clothes. I remember I had like I had all the Fat Albert gear. I had all the FUBU gear. I had all the Rockaware gear. I had all the Sean John gear. I had all the velour suits. Like, come back 8th grade, I'm a fast forward. Like, I don't want y'all to think I was just like, you know what I'm saying, something lame. No, 8th grade, I popped up. I had already left this school, but I said, man, fuck that school. And I went back over to Santa Barbara Middle School. Man, I was voted best dressed. Look in the yearbook. Like, voted best dressed ever since 8th grade, you know. But, so I started changing my style and started trying to find an identity. And that's what I see a lot of kids, they struggle with this regardless of what race they are, so-called race or so-called ethnicity, but they struggle with race and who they are and self-definition, which takes time. Like, nobody's going to tell that. Nobody's going to tell you that, and you're not going to find that out of yourself. So, I mean, outside of yourself. So that was something I struggled with a lot. You know, so I couldn't get down with that school, and missed a lot of days, and ended up leaving and going over to Santa Barbara, 8th grade. And, you know, I hated going to school. Listen, in terms of doing, like, testing and stuff like that, on reading comprehension skills, vocabulary, writing, critical thinking, I would be scoring, like, every standardized test. I remember I would score in between the 93, 94 percentile up into the 98. I remember a lot of them, I'd be getting, like, 99 percentiles, like, perfect scores on all of that. And, like, everything I'm saying is the truth. Like, I had another, like, you're going to end up watching all my videos because you're going to want to see, you know, how I came to be what I am now. And so that's why I said, like, you couldn't indoctrinate me with your half-assed math. 90-degree angles, Euclidean geometry, 90-degree angles. I came to third period dressed in gold bangles. Like, fast forward to high school, I really was, like, coming through, like, fresh like that. And that was based off of the things that I was doing that, you know, were, I had no business doing at the time. But, you know, that was the level of my consciousness at that time. I wanted it. So I got it. But like in terms of Euclidean geometry, so I would like score real high on all the verbal type of stuff, you know, but in mathematics, I couldn't be indoctrinated with that math because that math was never natural. So I'd always score low on those math scores because it didn't resonate, didn't click with my mind. If you see a lot of Aboriginal people, we have a natural way of doing mathematics. Mathematics comes natural in the mind. And so that's why if you take like an Aborigine from Australia, it's been documented that they're mathematical geniuses. But if you put them into a westernized or Europeanized system of mathematics, they're going to really struggle. So I struggle with that type of stuff. But like 8th grade, I came back over there. And when I came back, that was when I was like my friend Jeremy that I had told you about 6th grade. I had a lot of issues. I started like looking like, okay, well, who am I supposed to hang out with? I guess I'm only supposed to hang out with black people because it started becoming there, these cliques popping up, you know, and, you know, I was playing ball and doing all that. So it's like, I related more to, the so-called black side of myself. We were dealing with the one drop rule. I related more to them because of the way that we were all treated, and it didn't even have to be on a overt level. You could feel it. You could feel it even in the way that the teacher would talk to you. You know, so anyways, long story short, I missed like, I don't know how many days there are in a school year, 180. I literally missed like close to 100. I almost, like I told you, the genius who barely passed. I almost was held back from 8th grade, you know. And 9th grade, this is when the ego started kicking in. Because by this time, I was really excelling with basketball. And I was varsity as a freshman. And listen, I was getting a lot of attention from girls, from older girls. Even when I was in seventh grade, like seventh grade, I had all these high school girls that like, you know, they drove BMWs and they were like, they wanted to really like holler at me. But I was like a little kid. See, my mind was like a real child. Like I was very scared of the opposite sex. Like I wasn't on some like cooties, but it was like I was very shy. You know what I'm saying? I was very shy. I was very reserved. And I just, my expression was playing ball. You know, and so I remember like Valentine's Day, seventh grade, the girls in high school or whatever, they made, I think they were 9th or 10th graders or whatever. They made me like all these cupcakes and this big ass cake. And it was like, you know, it said like, we love you. The whole like 9th grade, 10th grade class, we love you. You know what I mean? And I'm like, what? You know, and I remember I brought that home. And my mom was just like, she was just laughing, you know. And so like when I got into 9th grade, you know, I was playing ball, and I remember the first article I ever had was in the Santa Barbara News Press, and it said growing pains, and it had a picture of me. I was you know 13. I was 14. I was playing varsity as a freshman, starting and all that. And that's when I started getting some hype, just locally in my community and whatnot. And you know, my coach said, you know, he's got a chance to be, you know, great, you know, and this is the best freshman I've seen and coach and stuff like that. And I remember once again I was getting a lot of attention, and I didn't like attention. I didn't like eyes being on me. That's why I shied away from that spotlight, because I didn't really want it like that. I played ball to begin because I just liked it. Like, I loved doing it. But then when they started coming like a little bit of notoriety and stuff, I started shying away from it. I'm like, damn, like, am I worthy of this? You see, I didn't have that great deal of self-assurance. You know, I was like, damn, this is kind of, I didn't really want this. I like to just move incognito. I didn't like people like walking around like, oh, you know what I'm saying? Hey, oh, you play so good. Like, I wasn't used to that. You know, I had all these girls that was just like on me. You know, and they were on me tough. Like, oh, we want to go out to lunch with you and do this. I'm talking about seniors. And I was just like I said, 14. I didn't kiss the girl at that time. Like, I was just, I'm telling you, I was innocent. And, like, they were trying to get it popping. I never drunk, never smoked, never did none of that. But, you know, I started feeling certain emotions and things, because I was starting to, you know, mature a little bit. And that was when a lot of depression started kicking in. I started feeling depressed. And there was no reason why. I didn't have a reason in my mind why. I would sleep, like, I'm telling you, I would sleep until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. A lot of times I wouldn't go to school. I'd be like, man, see, after that basketball season, I literally stopped going to school. I stopped going to class because my mom had to be at work. We live like off a street called Milpus at the time. And it was right down the street from the high school. So my mom had to be at work at her job at like 8. And, you know, she's like, you know, you could walk to school. I'm all right. I'm going to get up in a minute. And I'd just be sleeping all day. Maybe I go to like 6th period and like play ball, but I ended up with a 1.8 GPA. And they were like, I remember Carlos Williams told me, he's like, you're never, this was a advisor, so-called advisor. He was like, you're never going to play, you're never going to go to college, basically. You're definitely never going to play Division I basketball, just based off of the grades that I had for that one semester. But I was like, yeah, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. Also, the assistant coach, I'm not even going to put the names on blast like that. But the assistant coach was telling me like, yeah, you're never going to play Division I basketball, this and that, telling a 14-year-old kid that, you know. And that was one of my goals. I told you, I always made my goals. I always achieved my goals. One of my goals, I used to ask my dad, we'll go and play ball at Peabody Charter. That's the elementary school that I went to. Like, me and my dad, we used to always do everything together, you know, because him coming from where he came from, he didn't really fit into the society. So we were like best friends, you know, and still are. And so it was like, we'll just go throw the baseball together. We'll throw the football together. We'll kick the soccer ball together. We'll hit parks. You know what I mean? We'll go, you just go and just fly kites out in nature and just do all kinds of stuff. And we'll go play ball and do that type of stuff outside at the elementary school I went to on weekends and stuff like that. And that was always really fun, you know. But that depression just started really setting in. That depression started setting in. This is where I started questioning things, thinking more, you know. And you know, I remember asking my dad, like, yo, do you think I'll be able to play Pac-10 basketball? That was my goal. I think now it's called the Pac-12. But, you know, I was like, man, will I be able to play Pac-10 basketball? He looked at me, he said, son, you're going to do whatever you want to do. There's no limit to what you're going to do. You know, fast forward, I was doing it. But, you know, I had people telling me, you're not going to do this. You're not going to amount to anything. Those are just aspects of yourself those are your aspects of your own doubt that's just being projected outwardly from outside of yourself. So that's that. Now, you know, 8th, 9th grade goes through. I ended up transferring schools. I was living with my mom at the time. I missed all those days of school. I ended up transferring schools and going and moving out to a place called Oxnard. New beginning, didn't know anybody. My best friend came with me. Shout out. I don't even got to say nothing. You know what this is. You know what I'm talking about. So that was 10th grade. That's when things started picking up a little bit. Prior to that, I had never, you know, drank before. You know what I mean? I never had smoked no herb. None of that type of stuff was, I didn't mess with that. You know, once I turned about, I never had sex with a girl. I never even kissed a girl. You know, and so it was like, you know, and here's one of the issues. Here's one of the major issues. It was like when I was in 9th grade, I had all these girls that wanted to get to know me, that wanted to talk to me. And I tell you, I was so shy. They'd be like, oh, let's go to lunch. Let's do this. I would go either go in the gym and play basketball, or I would go like in one of my teacher's classrooms and like eat in there, because I didn't like that attention. Like, I was very, very to myself. I'm only child. Both of my parents were very reclusive, you know. And so, like, I didn't like that. I'll just go sit in the class. And so people were like, oh, what? You gay or something? When they started throwing that around, I'm like, nah, it ain't that. I'm just shy. Like, I'm really shy. You know, I'm very shy at that time. And, you know, I started picking it up once I hit like 10th grade, you know. And like they say, you know, it's that once you get that first taste of some stuff, you just, let's just say I started wilding out early. That's why a lot of the things that people are still doing when they're in their 20s, I was 16, 17, 18. I was doing stuff that, you know, people that's in their 20s probably not even really doing in terms of just some of the stuff that I was doing outside of playing ball. You know, I have moved away from living with my mom at the time. You know, we had a setup where it would be like 3 days here, 4 days there. It was, you know, it was a pretty cool relationship, you know. And, you know, my dad was living out in Oxnard at the time. So I moved out there, playing ball there. And you know, that was the first time when I started doing some other stuff. I was listening to a lot of I realized that's why I say don't listen to music, listen at it, because all that stuff influences your mind. I was listening to a lot of music from Texas at the time, and that Chopped and Screwed, and it really influenced me. I started sipping syrup, drinking lean, and I remember that was when, you know, I started getting active sexually, smoking. We'd be smoking all the time. I remember drinking lean. I'll tell you this. I remember we would fake coughs, and we would go to the pharmacy, go to the urgent care and get prescriptions. and we'll just be getting all kinds, ounces and ounces, like eight ounces bottles of the syrup, and just be drinking that. And like, I remember even I got a prescription one time, you know, me and my boy, you know what I'm saying? You see me with a B-Tizzle, you know, like we'd get a prescription and go. And I remember I took the prescription to Rite Aid, and it was like an old man that was working in the back of the pharmacy and filling up the bottles. And he had a pint, that's 16 ounces, right? A pint of the syrup. And I reached over, I had long ass arms, I reached over the big ass glass thing, and I jacked the pint and put it in my shirt, and we just jammed out of the store. And so what we had at that time, we had a pint, we had 2 8s, so that's another pint, we had 2 pints, and then we had a 4, meaning 4 ounces. And I took it all back to my house, and we was looking at it, we like, damn, this is gonna take us all year to drink. Man, we poured up a 5 or a 6 or an 8 or something crazy each, and just sat there and drank that and went numb. And now looking back, I realized, damn, that's why I say, if it's cool to be a fool, I guess I'm gonna finish last. Cause God's son don't play that shit. You know, I don't need that. That just numbs and dulls the mind, dulls the senses. You know, now I realize what it really is. It's an opiate, it's liquid heroin. So I remember drinking a 5 and then going to practice the next day. That's what I practiced. And I couldn't even, like, bro, I'll tell you, we were running lines, which is where you got to touch each line on the court. And I could barely run like 2 lines. I was like, I was drained out, you know. But yeah, so I was doing a lot of that type of stuff and still playing ball, but I wasn't fully focused in, and I was just super talented. And so we're going to fast forward up until about the age of 16. This is where it really starts dealing with the spiritual path and that spiritual journey. Okay, so it's about 15, 16 is when I started getting into conspiracies. That's when I started looking at that shit, 9/11 and all that, which, like I said, I'm past all this now. This don't even exist in the reality that I'm living in right now. But we're talking about this old world and, you know, what led me to be where I'm at now. Okay, so all that, I was looking at these movies called Zeitgeist, conspiracy theories, and all that type of stuff. And I got really deep into it. About 15, 16. That's when I started really studying. I remember getting the book, Behold the Pale Horse, William Cooper. I had it delivered to my house. You know what I mean? And so I was reading all that, reading up on all that type of stuff. And that was when I started really questioning things. And that was a place where I was, you know, at that time, that was what, sophomore, junior year, I was like one of the best players in the state of California, top, you know, 25, 30 or whatever in the nation. And things were really popping, like basketball wise, you know, getting recruited. I remember having the coach of Arizona, Lute Olson, was coming to my practices, and, you know, that was my dream school at the time. But I never really believed in myself like that. I didn't really believe in myself like that. I knew I was talented, but everybody else was like, damn, you the shit, you finna really. I remember Steve, my coach in the Rebels, Steve, and it was George. You know, these are two people that were highly influential in getting my basketball stuff popping off early with the 805 and with Oxnard Rebels, you know. And George Albanez, Steve Moorhead, you know. And I appreciate everything that they did, you know, to help me. And so it was like, he told me, Steve said, it was a game we played against this team called Paris in the CIF. What was it, like quarterfinal or something? And I just went off. Like, I had like 30 and 17 or 30 and 15. He told me afterwards, he's like, yo, he said, you're going to be the shit. Just don't get a big head. I already had a big head. I was already, my ego was boosted up, but my confidence was low. It was like a fake ego. I didn't really have that much confidence, but I just, shit. I had articles in the newspaper. I was, you know what I mean? I had all the girls because I was playing out there in Oxnard, but then on the weekends I could go back to Santa Barbara. And mind you, at this time I'm 15, 16. This is when the depression kicked in, and this is when I started really searching for a deeper meaning in my life. Because let me put it like this. I was 16. I was playing for a team called Pump and Run. That was Adidas sponsored. And I remember when they first got me to play for their team, the two brothers who were basically, you know, West Coast representatives for the whole Adidas joint, they took me and my pops out to Camarillo, out to the outlets, and they told me, yo, you can get whatever you want. I said, whatever I want? Oh, I went wild. I spent like $1,500. I got 8 pairs of shoes, all kinds of track suits, all kinds of like hats, everything. 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 You know, and it was like that. And I remember I had like so many pairs of shoes. I had all kinds of J's. I had like everything. And when you think about it, that's like what every kid wants at that age. You know, since I was getting a scholarship, you know, my dad had told me, like, yo, we're going to get you a car, you know, since you're going to have a scholarship playing basketball. We're not going to pay for anything. So I ended up getting a Cadillac CTS. Now, mind you, at this time, I started taking stuff that didn't belong to me. I didn't need to, but I just did because I felt like everything belonged to me. I felt like I was supposed to have everything that I wanted. I felt a sense of entitlement. I'm just going to be real. I felt a sense of entitlement. Because to be 100%, everything does belong to me because I am everything. But there's a right and a wrong way when we're dealing with polarities of going about doing it and getting it. But me, I said, no, I want it now. I'm going to take it. So we'd hit up the outlets as well, run up in Polo and just boosted. Nike outlet, boom, boosting. And you know, so I had a closet full of that, you know, taking things, selling them, making money. That's how I bought. Look, I got the car, I had the CTS, and then I didn't have no job. I went and bought rims for my car. I spent like 2 G's on the rims. Went and got a system, a couple thousand on the system, put wood grain all inside of it, wood grain kits, put a mesh grill. Like, these things cost. Like I told you, I was getting it in different ways that are neither here nor there, you know, and they're all part of the process. They're all part of the growth. And that's the beautiful thing is that, you know, I can talk about it freely because I'm not in that state anymore. The past don't even exist. It's just a process to get me to where I'm at now. And so, you know, I had this vehicle. I had all the shoes. Like I said, I was living in this town called Oxnard. And on the weekends, I'd go to Santa Barbara. And, you know, I'd go out with the homie Julian, Jay Stone. What's good? You know, and I had the chicks over there. So, I mean, it was like I was doing everything, playing ball, off-state. And, you know, for a kid, everybody from the outside. Oh, and then I had a scholarship. I had a scholarship to the University of California, you know, Berkeley or whatever. And but I was the most depressed, the most saddest. Like, I was like, it's got to be something more. But I was never down with the religion. I was never forced into religion. That's one of the most best things about, you know, my upbringing. I wasn't forced into no church. So, you know, the biggest ages of development for a child is what? The ages of like 1 to 7. You know, that's when they're most programmable. You know, so if you have a child growing up 9, 10 years old and you have them in the church, they're going to believe in that figure. They're going to believe in something outside themselves. I never believed in shit much of anything. I was just living. I didn't care. It wasn't until I started looking in conspiracies and then feeling like, damn, why do I feel like this? Why do I have all the stuff that this society is telling me I'm supposed to aspire to have, but I still feel like shit. I feel terrible. I wake up every morning And I asked myself, is life worth living? Should I blast myself? I really was thinking like, I don't even really want to be here. So that led me into some journeying. And once again, it started with just, it started really with the conspiracy stuff. Not so much on the spiritual tip, but that's how it starts. You got to start somewhere. And so, you know, I went through all that. And, I had everything that a kid could want, you know. I just didn't feel good. I wasn't happy. And finished out high school. I had done a lot of things. And I always had my spirits and my ancestors always protecting me and watching over me, because I even got caught stealing from boosting the polo store for like, I want to say 1800. I'm telling you, I had these leather jackets, like polo leather jackets. I had a black one, and I had a light brown, a dark, like a caramel, same color, my skin kind of brown. That shit was clean. But I took all this stuff, and I never took the tag off of it. I just kept it under my bed. And long story short, I went out there with another dude who was playing ball at, it was a couple of us. We had a getaway driver. We planned it out. He was like, we finna come up out here. And let me say this too. I don't regret anything that I've done. If I could go back in time, I wouldn't change anything that I've ever done. Because they've all been lessons. And they've all helped me grow. So that guilt and that feeling, that don't exist. If I went back in time and I was like living outside of myself, and I'm like, well, can you make this decision again? And it's going to lead you exactly to where you're at now and where you're about to go. But if you don't do it, then you're not going to experience this, that, and that. I'll go through all this pain. At the same time, if I could be smarter and do it without the pain, that might be better too. But now that I've passed through it all, I realize that all the things that I've done and all the pain I've had to experience, that was the alchemical process. You see, that was the turning lead into gold. That was turning lead into gold. You know, and that's why I am the golden child. That's why I am God's son at this stage. Because I had to go through all those things. A lot of people not willing to go through the stuff that I've gone through. We're going to get into that. This story is going to really pick up here. You know. Story's really going to pick up. I'm going to take a quick little break once I get into this college area. Because I was just dealing with like, you know, the elementary phase and that type of stuff. And some of the things I was going through and dealing with. And then also... I want to touch on that too. Like I saw my dad. I saw him, you know, progress. I saw him go through certain things. I saw my mom, struggle with certain stuff. I remember we were living like for a short period of time. I think my dad had lost his job or, you know, whatever. He was in the transition stage, and we were living in a boxing gym. I'm gonna document this and show you where we were living at, staying at for a period of time. And I remember like, you know, he never talked about money with me like that. That was never an issue. They always wanted me to feel like we always had it. But I remember we were living in a Primo. It's called Primo Boxing Club on Haley Street. And we were living in like a back little area, like me and him. And I remember this. I remember like I didn't know that he didn't have anything really. But it was like we went to, I want to say like Burger King or one of these old world places that it's not important anymore. But we went to this place and he got me food, and I remember he didn't even eat anything. He wasn't eating. And now I look back and he's like, I don't want anything. But, you know, he only had enough and he made sure I ate. You know, and he constantly progressed. He constantly elevated. My mom constantly showed me love. You know, I remember all these other kids, they had brand new Jordans on. They had the, I love the Scottie Pippen shoes. I love the original KGs, the original Kevin Garnett kicks. I don't even know what they're called or whatever, like the Air Max, whatever. But they're like the they had the different colors and shades of blue on them, black and blue. And so like I remember going to Foot Locker a lot with my mom, and she didn't have money like that. She was working retail. It's not like it was all kinds of disposable income, but every single time she would get me whatever the shoe was. A lot of times she's like, no, I can't do it. We'll leave, and I'd start, you know, having my little tantrums, like, she's like, all right, come on, let's go back. She's put it on her credit card. Anything to help me, anything to make me feel better or happier, they'll do it for me. And that's why I love them. That's why I bought them. And it's not about money, but that's why I got them everything they ever wanted. I got them everything they ever needed, anything they ever wanted, because they've been through me, been there for me through every single phase of the way. They are the angels placed into my life. They are guides on my path. And so, like, we're going to move into the next phase of my life, which is dealing with college, dealing with a lot of that type of stuff, and then starting to get into some spirituality and really how I came to become, you know, what I am. So brief little intermission right here. And if I think of anything else, I'm just going to add it in. But, you know, I'm just going to testify. And real quick, what I was finishing up with, dealing with, like I said, my spirits and my ancestors that have always been with me, is because I did a whole lot of stuff that I shouldn't have done. A whole lot of things I shouldn't have done. And like I was saying, like, I took from myself, I took like $1,800 worth of stuff real quick, just that on that one hit, on that one lick. And this nigga, you know who you are, Buena High School, tall ass. This dude, 6'5". I might as well just put the names out there because we all grown and it don't even matter. Will. He went up in there. Mind you, this dude is like 6'5", 6'6". Had an afro or braids. And we went in there boosted. And then this dude came back the next day. The next day with his girl. And yeah, got caught. And they had the video and all that. So long story short, I had to go back in there and bring all the stuff back. And luckily, I never took any of the tags or nothing like that off. And it's crazy because the manager of the store was named Leanne. And she was actually one of the coaches of the other kids that I was with. Their youth coach. You know, so it was fucked up. Like, that was their youth coach, and we was in there, and they was, you know, we was all taken from the store that she was managing. So had it not worked out like that, you know, I had to go to some type of like meeting or something like that at the police station in Camarillo where it was just dealing with like youth, and I had to listen to like some prisoners and stuff like that share their experience and kind of like a scared straight kind of experience. But see, something like that, if I wasn't protected, if I didn't have you know, a higher calling and stuff, things like that, is that's juvenile, that's getting that scholarship taken back, and that's, you know, that could be it right there, you know. So there's been a number of those type of instances that have happened, but I always have been able to, I don't like to use the word blessed because I can never be less, but in the sense I'm using, I always have had those higher blessings coming from my higher self. Because remember, God only looks after children and fools. God only looks after children and fools, and I was both. I was both a child and a fool. And when I say God, anytime I'm saying God, I always want people to realize it's no God outside of self. God is your higher self that lives within you. Just like in that Bible, the kingdom of heaven is within. The kingdom of heaven is within. Why go to the church outside when there's seven within you? You know? So that's the main reason I don't feel bad about these things. I don't feel regretful, because if you knew better, you'd do better. And I guess I knew better. But at the same time, I'm a fool. I'm a child. When I thought as a child, I made decisions as a child. As I became a man, I started to make decisions as a man. As I became God in consciousness, we talking about that Christ consciousness. It's all about consciousness. When I say a child, you thinking in terms of a childlike mind, but not in the positive, so-called positive sense. You're talking about like making foolish decisions, foolish pride, foolish ego. So when you're in those stages, you know, them spirits is going to be around you trying to help you and make sure that you don't get chopped down, because you're blind, third eye blind. You see what I'm saying? So I'm going to take this little brief intermission right here. Enjoy this. And let this one run right here. I hope y'all are feeling this. I know you're feeling this, but it's really just for me. But I'm letting everybody in. And this is the only time I'm going to discuss any of this stuff. So, y'all reporters, you want to ask, you can refer back to this. It's everything. I remember why I broke the rules, 'cause I ain't really have nobody to look up to.
I remember cutting class,
being bad, 'cause I ain't have what them other kids had.
I remember wishing that I knew my dad, and I remember wishing I could get him back. For every night that he told me he was coming and he didn't, for every single dollar that my mama knew was missing, for everything I wanted and was told.
Trouble ever since my mama put me out. Damn, it's getting real.
Damn, it's getting real. Didn't graduate, I'm thinking, damn, I got a deal. So I hit the block, selling rocks just to eat a meal. So I grabbed the Glock, kept the God pieces being still. Back to the trucks, my nigga stay with the pucks. And if a nigga was keeping my brother, stay with the guts. And then yeah, we stayed in the truck, yeah, every day in the truck. These hoes was chasing the cheese, so we would stay.
Tell my niggas have to roll out. Got motivated, my inspiration don't run out. And it hurting me to my heart. So I can't stop in no crib. I won't stop in no car. Nothing can stand in my way. Just for my niggas up every way. I'ma tell the truth and the whole truth.
Cause it ain't no need to lie, and I ain't tryna keep it on the side. So I gotta testify, you and I testify. I'ma tell the truth and the whole truth, cause there ain't no need to lie, and I ain't tryna keep it on the side. I gotta testify, for you and I testify. I'ma tell the truth and the whole truth, cause there ain't no need to lie, and I ain't tryna keep it on the side. So I gotta testify, for you and I testify. Cause there ain't no need to lie, and I ain't tryna keep it on the side. So I gotta testify, for you and I testify. I testify. I testify.
That's the first joint I played is Lloyd called True, and this one's August Alsina Testify. Now, here's where the story starts to really pick up. I got that scholarship to go play at Cal. Now, when I first got out there, I was 18, finally living on my own, you know, away from my family and stuff like that. I was wilding already. I remember I first got out there and I already was just like turning up, drinking, partying, doing all that other stuff, extracurricular stuff. And I had an issue with my calf. I had a surgery on that. To be honest with you, I could have played. Once again, I was operating out of fear. I really was afraid to really be on that level. I never even felt like I didn't feel like I was really worthy of even playing on that level. Like, it was like, damn, I'm talented. I never felt like I was supposed to. I felt like I was supposed to, but I was like, I ended up having a surgery and just sat out and redshirted, meaning I didn't play. I didn't play that year. I was dealing with depression, anxiety, crazy anxiety. I remember my nervous system started to have some issues even when I was in high school. I'll dunk on somebody, then the next time I'll go to the free throw line because I couldn't handle pressure. I couldn't handle like a lot of people. I'd get real nervous. I had anxiety issues, and I remember I'd get the ball and shoot a free throw sometimes and my hands would be shaking like this. My nervous system was a little out of whack, and I shoot it and throw up an air ball or something. Air ball, overrated. And then the next play, like I always been on this chaos melanin. The next play I'll come in, whop, hit a three. Or the next play I'll go and just whop, dunk on a motherfucker and pop my collar at the crowd. You know what I'm saying? And then, so it was like, how you airball the free throw and then go and hit a three-pointer and dunk on somebody and pop your collar and catch a technical? Like, that don't really go together. That's chaos energy. But you see, I didn't have knowledge of self, so I was unsure and uncertain about myself. I had that surgery, and that was when I started having some issues, you know, with I had the pain medication that they gave me. Remember, I was dealing with that Norco. And I'm going to tell you like this. I know a whole lot of football players, a whole lot of basketball players. There's other people on my team that have had surgeries. And that's common. Messing with the Vicodins and the Norco and all that type of stuff that doesn't even exist anymore. Like, yeah, I was on that. And I also want to put it out there that To every girl, you know, that I was with in my previous life, because this to me, the being that I'm talking about is dead. That being no longer exists. Where does it exist other than in the memory? And so I'm talking about it to release it from the memory and to just get it out, because it doesn't exist anymore. I'm a new being. I'm a new entity. But I do want to say this. And I'm hesitant to put all the names out like that But at the same time, it's like, I might as well. It's part of the story. Sarah. Brittany. Netta, all y'all, and all the other, and there's been other, a lot of other girls that I had interactions with and encounters with in this old previous lifetime that I lived. And all of y'all were always, like, I'm telling you, the girls that I've been with in the past, there was nothing wrong with them. Remember, everything is me being reflected, so any type of problems and things that was experienced, it was my creation. You know what I mean? I created everything. I'm the creator. And so, like, let's just say that the girls that I had dealt with, even at Cal, and I, these were girls that are like prime candidates for being somebody's wife. I mean, being somebody's husband and wife, or, you know what I'm saying, like real good people, good beings and good spirits and souls and whatnot, you know. But getting that out the way, you know, I was going through a lot, and I was doing a lot of off the course stuff. And since the statute of limitations is up, I'm gonna talk about it. Even if it wasn't up, it's irrelevant because I'm not that being any longer. But I was jacking the laptop, cell phones, all kinds of stuff, running up in the house and doing some other, you know, things. That's why I say, like, all this stuff that they're talking about in these hip-hop songs and rap songs, like, oh, it's cool to do this, it's cool to do, nah, that's not cool. It's not cool to drink Ambien. I mean, to take Ambien pills and drink a bottle of Hennessy and hit up a party and black out and be tripping out, and, you know what I'm saying, like, none of that shit is cool. It's not cool to go take, see what I'm saying? It's not cool to go take some shit and sell it and try to make profit like that. Like, why? Why take when I could just manifest it and draw it to me naturally? You see, that's what a fool would do. A god body just going to sit here, close their eyes, breathe and visualize it coming directly to them without any effort. And so, you know, I was doing all these things, boosting, and even selling, like, you know, other athletes may have a laptop that they may have gotten, and, you know, I just take it, throw it online, sell it for them, take a small percentage, and give them the rest. I didn't really care like that. So, you know, ended up getting in some issues with that, and that's what I ultimately led to me being dismissed from that team. And from that, I wasn't kicked out of the school, I was just dismissed from the team. And basically, so that right there really made me, like, damn, start thinking, like, I don't want to live like this. I wasn't really raised to be like this. I was brought up to be a good kid, like, to do things just the right way. You know, my parents were both hard workers. They weren't, like, people that were going to try to take or steal or do none of that shit. They just was like, they'll live. They'll work hard. You know, and so I remember going back home, and this was one of my lower points. I went back home. This was 2009. I went back home, and I remember my mom looking at me in the eye. You know, she said, who are you? She was crying, and she said, who are you? You're not the child I raised. And that hit me like, damn. But I was numb. I'm telling you, I was numb. I'm just now releasing this numbness. And the numbness that I've been experiencing now is based off of the last just couple years that I'm going to get into. But I was numb back then. She looked at me in the eye and said, who are you? You're not the child I raised. You know? And I felt like I just had failed, you know. And that was when I started really just seeking after some type of a spiritual truth. But you see, I didn't have a high level of real knowledge at that time. And so, you know, the first thing you're going to be funneled into is going to be the church. That's it. So I started going to church and getting heavy into that. And like I'm telling you right now, like, excuse self, like DMX said, he said, I've been through mad different phases like Masons to find my way. And now I know that happy days are not far away. If I'm strong enough, I'll live long enough to see my kids doing something more productive, more constructive with their time than bids. You know, but what he said is, like, I've been through mad different phases like Masons to find my way. And I've been through a whole lot of different phases. And that's the constant change, that's the constant growth, the constant evolution that's necessary to become, to becoming. Like, you have to go through changes. If you're not constantly changing, then you're not constantly growing. And so one of the parts of my growth and my change was getting involved in the church. And it's been extremely helpful because now I know the Bible. I read the Bible multiple times. I read the Quran. You know, I read the Torah. I read everything. I read the Bhagavad Gita. You know, I studied the pyramid text, the Book of the Dead. Like, what else? You know, the Upanishads. Like, a lot of the Popol Vuh, whatever, the ancient Mayan texts, all these different texts I studied and read, you know. And so dealing with the Christianity thing, that was like the first thing that I could go to. And, you know, I remember going to, I wasn't allowed to go into, like, this is before I had left Berkeley. And I was kicked off of the team, but I was still going to school. But I wasn't even, like, talking to none of the people that was on that team or anything. I was just isolated. And I was going through a lot. And I was just smoking weed and, like, you know, be really just spaced out. And I remember I just got high on a Sunday and I went into the church. And, like, it was a female pastor. And I stayed after and I started talking to her and just broke down. She started having me, like, pray with her and do all this type of stuff. Now, I went back home, and it's written right here. Let me see. Right there, it say 5/30/10. 5/30/2010. May 30th, 2010 was a day I never will forget. Because I was back home, and like I said, I lost everything. I wasn't going to school there any longer. I didn't know if I was going to go back to school. I didn't know if I was going to play basketball again. I didn't know what I was about to do. And shit, I was just getting high. I get high, and I got high, and I was starting to try to find answers. And I remember going to the beach, walking on the beach. I went with my mom, and I ran. I went ahead of her, and there was this girl. She was reading on the beach, real pretty little girl, you know. And I just, like, walked up and started talking to her. Long story short, she was a Christian. She went to her name was Brianna, but she went to this school. I forgot what it's called. It's out in Riverside. It's like a Christian school, or whatever. And you know, I was like, yo, let's you know, we could meet up later. And so I ended up meeting up with her at, like, damn near 2 in the morning. She was in Carpinteria with her family doing a, like, a little, I guess they were just camping or whatever. And so I just met up with her, and we just were talking. And, you know, I was telling her about what had happened with me and everything like that. And, like, we started praying. like started praying with me. And this was the first time I had ever like prayed or tried to talk to the higher power, that higher power that lives within. And I had my eyes closed, and I remember just praying, and all of a sudden this spirit come to me. It was two different spirits that came to me, and one of the spirits was like, because I was only dealing on the paradigm of good and evil at that time, so it's going to appear and approach you in that same type of paradigm. So I was dealing on that paradigm, and so it was something that would resemble like the devil or like your lower self, you know. And it came to me and said, just do everything that you're doing, stay on the same path you're on, and you're gonna have everything you ever wanted, all the money, all the fame, all the women, all the power. I'm gonna give you everything, you'll have it all, everything. I'm telling you, I was high out of my mind, and it came to me, and I refused. I said, no, I don't want that. But inside of me, I was at a low point. I almost was like gonna take on that offer. And now I understand, like, when people talk about selling their souls and all that type of stuff, this is very real. What that really is meaning is that you're selling yourself, your true self, your higher self. You selling that out for material gain and acquisition. But you see, I already had developed a certain sense to where I just started knowing, like, okay, that's not right. Like, not that there truly, because this is all an illusion, but in the sense of this story that I've been living, I'm like, that's not for me. What does it profit a man to gain the world yet lose his soul? What does it profit a man to gain the world yet lose his soul? And so, you know, I refused. And then something else came right after that. Boom. Come to me. Come to me. And I will use you. I will use you. I will change you. I will make you into what you are destined to be. Listen, that second energy was peaceful. That second energy didn't promise me anything. All it promised to do was use me for a big, big purpose. I'm telling you, I was close to going that other way, very close. I felt broken. I felt worthless. But I said, I'm going with the other side. I'm going with the side where I can be used. I can be utilized. I don't know what for, but I'm just going to go with that. And I'm telling you, it was a vision. It was deep. I've had other visions more in recent years. You know, real visions of what's to come. And I tell you this too, even as a child, when I sleep, sometimes I get these crazy dreams of, and it would literally be feelings of explosions in my brain, seeing and watching the world in a state of destruction, to be rebuilt and reborn and rebirthed. This was the most vividest things I would see. I blocked it out though. Now, I said, okay, I want to be used. And now I realize what that was my egoic self realizing and committing to the higher self, to really start that alchemical process in a higher order, so I can merge back in with my divine nature. That other being that was talking to me, that higher being, was just an aspect of myself. Whether or not it came in the form of
any entity, that's irrelevant, because these are just thought forms that are created. So somebody in you know what I mean, Afghanistan may see Muhammad come and speak to them because that's what their paradigm has been based off of. The other individual that's living in whatever, you know what I'm saying, Texas, might see this Jesus figure come and speak to them. Somebody else may see Buddha. They're all just symbols of and aspects of your higher self. You're not supposed to look at it like as an actual entity outside of yourself, because nothing exists outside of self. So I started going to church a lot doing that, and I realized that that was the perfect thing for me at the time, because that gave me some kind of structure and something that I could do to kind of help me get on my awakened path. Started reading a lot, you know. My pops had got me a lot of books on dealing with the mind, you know what I mean? Basic, The Secret, Think and Grow Rich, How to Win Friends and Influence People, you know, books on positive self-development and growth. And so I started reading these books and started elevating my state of being, my state of mind. And one of the issues I always had with the church was that there was a whole lot of things I just didn't vibe with. I couldn't feel. Remember, I'm dealing with feeling. How does it feel? And I'm not talking about on that lower sense, like, oh, it feels good, I'm gonna do it. No rubber. Oh, not like that. I mean, feeling in terms of like, well, I don't feel this. I see everybody else with their hands extended like this, like something outside of themselves, like, and I never felt that. I'd be trying to do it. Oh, say, yeah, you know what I'm saying? But like, it never really resonated like that, and I was forcing it. But you know, I continued on for a little while with that. And so what happened was I ended up transferring to a school called Cal State Fullerton, the Titans. Mind you, all this stuff is spiritual. Titans, the Titanic race, that's the original beings. The Titans are above the gods, you know. So I went for the Titans. And I remember seeing, when I first went there on a visit, I saw all the jerseys in the rafters. And I said, my jersey's going to be up there, retired. That's just a fact. That's just a fact. That's what I put in my mind. And mind you too, it's been numerous times where I knew where I was going to go and where I was going to be, and that it would all come to fruition. You know, little hints and instances where it was brought to my attention. But, you know, I joined the FCA, which is Fellowship for Christian Athletes. Started talking and mentoring with some kids and stuff like that. And, you know, I always have had a gift to speak, you know, and to project my mind outwardly. Very influential. Always been a natural born leader, but I was always, like I said, my dad told me I'd influence millions, and I was afraid to come into that. I really truly was afraid to come into that space of myself. But you know, I did the SCA thing, and real quickly they were already like, well, we want you to be like basically one of the leaders or presidents of this organization at the university, you know. And I was like, I can't do it. That's when I checked out, because I didn't even really believe in it to begin with. I didn't really believe in the story. It's like, yo, you have to believe in this. You got to believe in this doctrine, and then you'll be saved. Like, but I didn't really believe it, because I always felt that salvation wasn't supposed to come from like some outside entity. The salvation is, you know, to save thyself. Because you're everything. So it doesn't make sense to me. It never made sense to me to go outside of myself for any answer. Because every time you go outside of yourself, you have more questions than answers. So I started going within. I finished up school over there. And that's when I started playing overseas, Europe and stuff like that. And I remember I got cut from my first team. I got cut from my team in Greece within a month. I didn't even play a game. And they cut me. They're like, oh, well, cut his ass. They let me go. Boom. Then I went up to Macedonia. Cold as hell, like super, super cold. The gym would be so cold. They didn't have no heat or nothing. We'll be working. Sometimes we'll practice in full sweatsuits on with some people wear gloves and practice with the gloves on. I remember, like, you'll be breathing and it'll just be, you'll see all the, steam coming out of the mouth. It was like crazy, and my bones and stuff. Like, I'd be experiencing all kinds of tendonitis and all that type of stuff just because it was too cold, It's crazy. Walking through the snow to practice and doing all that. But it was all part of the experience. I remember when I got cut from that team too, 3 months in, and that, I started thinking, man, do I even want to play ball anymore and all this and that. It's been a couple times I knew I was going to the league. One of them was when I was over there too, in Macedonia, and I was going through it, and the spirit just came to me like, you're going to go, you're gonna make it from there. And I'm like, what? For real? But it was so strong, I knew it. Same thing happened to me after I got kicked out of Cal, and I was back home in the backyard shooting on the backyard hoop, and I was laying down, and the spirit just came to me like, yo, you're gonna be the greatest. You're going to be the greatest. And so after I got cut from there, I came home for a little while and then ended up in Qatar. I went out to Qatar, and by this point I was just studying that, I went to Qatar. That's when I started studying the Quran, reading up on that, continuing to learn. That year went by. That next year I was in Spain. Spain was a great shift for me. I had a little stability. I stayed there for like 8 months. We'd only practice like 2, 3 hours out of the day, and the rest of the time I could spend studying. That's when I really picked up my studies. I started studying like all the ancient Kemetic sciences, all the old African histories, Dr. Ben, Dr. Muwatta Ashby. I was looking at like Huygens. I was looking at Francis Cress Welsing. I was pretty much all the master teachers. I wasn't too much on Bobby Hemmett at the time because I wasn't really ready for the metaphysics of it. It was just more all of the great historians, Dr. Clark. I don't want to leave names out. Hilliard. I mean, so many, all the master teachers. Baba Coleman, everything. I started getting a little more conscious. I actually ordered five to $500 worth of books and had my mom send me all these books. So I started reading more. I started doing meditations. I started getting more into the spiritual aspect, and that's when I started having certain awakening experiences. I left practice one day, and I kid you not, I've had a lot of these different experiences. I'll share one with them, but I walked right out of the gym, took a left, and a fish fell out of the sky. This might sound outlandish, but a fish fell out of the sky and pew, it hit the ground so hard, like it fell literally from like, damn, the top of the atmosphere or something. And I look up, like thinking there's gonna be a bird or something. The sky's completely clear and there's not a bird in the sky. It was one other girl that was walking on the street, only one other being that was walking on the street, walking towards me, and was like, just looked at me. I looked at her, and she just looked like, what the fuck? And it was frozen. The bird was frozen. I mean, the fish was a frozen fish. It fell way out the sky. I started having these like experiences where I'm like, what's going on, and they were just, inexplainable. So I went and played there, did that, after that experience, it wasn't. It's tough. It's tough being out there like that. So I came home again, and I said, I'm going to stay here. And I ended up going to the D League thing, NBA Development League. And I got drafted 21st overall in the NBA D League draft to the Detroit Pistons Development League team. And I was there for like a week. And at that time, I really had been really, really studying a whole lot. I spent the entire summer meditating. I didn't even work out like that. I just meditated to go within myself. And you see, I was like, my mind wasn't really there. And I had been studying quite a bit of, you know, what they would call magic, which is just a higher science. And I was very intrigued with Voodoo. I was very intrigued. I had a grimoire called the Spider and the Green Butterfly, or something called like along those lines. You can look it up if you're interested. But so I was into the Voodoo, Haitian Voodoo, because I realized how misunderstood it was, just like myself. Always misunderstood. But Haitian Voodoo, the Voodoo culture, is a West African spiritual system that was used to free and to liberate the Haitians from slavery and from, you know, colonialism and tyranny and all this type of stuff. And so, you know, I didn't really want to play ball. And I was like, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to light these candles. I'm going to go into this ritual and I'm going to go to sleep. And however I feel that this next morning is what I'm going to do. So I woke up and I didn't want to go to practice. I didn't feel it. I called the coach. I said, look, I'm going through some stuff. I'm done. You know, y'all going to give me a flight up out of here. And so I got a flight home. A week later, I booked a flight and a ticket out to Haiti to go and move and live in Haiti. Mind you, I didn't know Patois, didn't know no Creole, didn't speak French, didn't know anybody that's lived in Haiti. I just said, I'm going to go to Haiti. Booked a flight. Boom, I'm out. I'm on the airplane. Mind you, I'm getting like emails and stuff from family members, my uncle saying how disappointed they are in me. But at this point, I'm following a different path. I'm being spirit led. And it's not supposed to make any sense. That's the thing. These things aren't supposed to make sense to your conscious mind. You got to just go with it. And that's what I said. That's the difference between me and these other beings. Like the Obamas of the world. They don't got the heart to take the risks that I took. Remember, comfortability only breeds more comfortability, and you can't grow out of comfortability. You can only grow out of this. You see this? You can only grow out of uncertainty. You know? So I was never able to be boxed in or confined and forced into specific spaces. I always moved and maneuvered my way out. I always just did my own thing. I always had my own thoughts, my own mind, my own plans. And so I booked a flight. Mind you, once I'm on this level, I started experiencing a lot of things like, yo, what are you doing? You know? I'm like, yo, what am I doing when I was on the airplane going to Haiti? Like, yo, what are you doing? The same spirit came over me and said, don't worry. The first person you meet is going to help you. They're going to be with you. Now, here's where it started getting interesting. I get off the airplane. I hop off the airplane, get my bags. I walk outside. I don't know anybody out there. It's a few taxis out everywhere. Near taxi. It's wild. It's hustle and bustle. People trying to get like, you know, a dollar to eat. They're trying to make some money. So, I don't know. I hop in the taxi. Like, where are you going? I said, I don't know. He looked at me. He said, you don't know. You're in Haiti. You don't know where you're going? No. Just take me to a hotel. I had about $1,000 or something like that. That's all I had. And mind you, I had a one-way flight. Like, this is what I'm talking about, living off of faith. I had a one-way flight. Hopped off the airplane. I don't know. They sent me to a hotel. So they took me to this first hotel. It was two beds. It wasn't a hotel. It's like motels. Not no hotel like you look thinking of. I wasn't in no resorts. Like, I went right into what's it called? I've documented this. I had it all on video, and I don't have it anymore. It all got erased because none of this was meant to be shown. Everything that I did out there was not meant to be shown. It's a spiritual land. I was in Port-au-Prince. The heart. You know what I mean? Like, in the slums. What they call Delmas 40. Sac passe to all my Haitians. Y'all real. So, the first spot that they took me to was like, it got two beds in it, like two little beds. And I only needed one, so they took me to another spot, to another place. And the dude who was there, who helped me, he was just helping out, and he helped me. He like took me up to the room, to the space I was staying in, and he spoke English. Will Jean Charles. Cool. He was an aspect of myself. That was myself if I grew up in Haiti. Same exact being. We were the same being, just off a different lifestyle and different circumstances. You know, he had gone through all this shit and was still going and becoming an engineering student. You know, and so then that first day, I said, man, come back over here. I had a little cash, so I'm like, all right, let's go. Let's go to the store, you know what I mean? Get you some stuff to eat and everything. And, you know, we got a bottle of Bobanco. All my Haitians know what I'm talking about, that rum. And we just drank. We drank the Haitian rum, and he showed me outside, walking around and stuff. Mind you, y'all Americans or whatever, you can't do what I did. You can't go. That's why I said you can't walk my path. I walked around there with $300 headphones on and a tablet. But because my spirit was clean and the reason I was out there was different. Nobody touched me. Nobody did nothing to me. Y'all motherfuckers go out there with your iPhones and stuff, you're going to get hit. You're going to get hit. I'm telling you, I have motherfuckers that are, and this ain't like, you know what I mean? This is just to say this, but like, you're dealing with some whole different stuff out there. It's not for play. The machetes, like, dealing with some niggas that will really eat you, dealing with spirits, so you better be on point, you better have some good intent. And so, I didn't have the money to be staying in this space like that. I didn't have the money, I didn't have like $40 a day or whatever. You know, to be paying. So, Will Jean, this is how amazing it is. The first person that I met was the one who I stayed with the entire time. Now, he was being evicted from the little spot he was staying in that same exact day that I got there. I took $300 and we went and got this little tiny spot. Where he could get it for almost a year, I think, for $300 or $400. I think he had saved up a little bit of money. He had like $200. I had $300. So for like $500 or $300, whatever it was, you got a spot for the whole 6 months or a year. And that's where I was staying at with him. And Haiti, I had some strong experiences. Like I said, I was deep into the dealing with the ancestral energy and the spirit realm. And I'm not even going to speak too much on this. I went deep out into the jungle. And I met with him. And his eyes rolled back into his head. And all of a sudden, a voice started speaking through him in a tongue I had never heard. But I understood. And he said, everything that you do will prosper. You are guided and you are protected by powers greater than this earth has ever seen. I went out to the village also, the village that my good friend had his family living in. Mind you, these people had experienced everything because these are God's chosen. All original beings is God's chosen. I had about $100 and we went and got big old bag of rice, big old thing of rice, few of those. Beans, all this, and that's enough food for his mom. He had his mom, his little brother, his two sisters, and a grandfather. That's enough food for them to eat for the whole month off like 50 or 100 so-called dollars, you know. And they were like so thankful and appreciative, but it was like that's the least that I felt that I could do. And you know, his grandfather was never indoctrinated with the Christian program. His mom was, you know, a little bit, I think, but they keep their voodoo. They keep their voodoo. That's their culture. That's a system. It's like you can't. That's not a religion. It's a spiritual way of life. Like they, you know, and the grandfather was still heavily into that. And he took me aside. He gave me a candle. He put two lines in it, and he told me to burn it to one space and call on the ancestors, and then burn it to another and let it burn out throughout the night and then place it under the pillow. But what he did tell me, he touched my forehead. And this is a man that I had never met. He touched my forehead and he began to cry. He began to cry, and he told me that it's an old, old, frail man. In his eyes, you saw everything. His eyes was bloodshot and yellow, and you could tell he had been through it all. He looked at me and started crying, and he said, when I go, all of my powers are bestowed upon you. And he was crying. You know, I had several other experiences in Haiti. You know, the Haitian woman who was just looking at my aura. She wasn't even looking me in my eyes. And she just said, she was speaking in patois, looked to Wiljean and said, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, I want to go with him. He's going to do these amazing things. And I'm telling you, I was looking at him just like I'm looking at y'all right now. Like, what? For real, me? And so that was that. Like I said, a whole lot of other things transpired that I'm not gonna go deep into, because it's not part of this. But there were several spiritual experiences, and the one being that I was with was the one I was with the whole time. The first one I met, just like that spirit had told me. That's when I started to trust it. So, stayed there for a few months, ran out of money. Ended up coming back to the States. Got a job playing ball in Mexico. Ended up getting cut from that team. But you know what? Before I got cut, I got cut after I had I dropped like 30. It's like everything was like meant to be. The team was like doing real poorly or whatever. But you know, I was doing cool. You know, but it wasn't meant to be. But they released me. They cut me. And I looked at the manager and I said, "Look at this. Look at my eyes. I told him, look, I told him just like this, Renee, I think his name was Renee. I said, look me in my eyes. Look me in my eyes. I said, I'm special. I will be great. And I bounced. They took me to the airport. I had to cross the border and do all this. It was wild. When I first got out there, we was riding on these buses, 24 hours, like 18 hour bus rides and shit in the bus. The septic system in the it's a cheap ass bus, and the septic system wasn't working right, so it was smelling like just shit and piss all in there. Trying to sleep on the floors of the bus and stuff, traveling around Mexico. Like, this shit wasn't no, there wasn't no luxury lifestyle like people think it is. It was grimy, you know. But I left there, and that's when I started really, you know, I had been doing some other things, dealing with the plant medicines. I told you I'm very spiritual. It's a thin line between shamanism and schizophrenia. It's just about how well you can integrate it into this fake matrix here. And now I've finally been able to integrate it. But at that time, I was all over because it was so much coming in at one time. So I was using I was working with the spirit of San Pedro cactus. I was working with the spirit of the mushroom, you know. And it was showing me a lot of things, a lot of truth. So one day I ate some mushrooms, lit my candles, did the ritual, and gained automatic handwriting. And I wrote a letter. I didn't write a letter. It wrote the letter through me. And it was to be delivered to the Vatican. Jesus is dead. God is dead. I am alive. I was instructed to burn the corners. To take blood and put it all on the letter. To add the element of water. And lastly, to add the element of the earth. To close it. To add specific seals and to deliver it to the Vatican. I went and I did just that. And if you want to show and prove, you can even check it out. They took me in to the station, took a DNA swab. I'm telling you, we're dealing with Christ figures and Christ energy. And then let me roll. So whoever wants to go and do that, you know, background check and whatnot. I was in Italy. Ain't none of this shit is made up. This is my true story. I'm telling y'all the truth. Right there at the Vatican. And I delivered it to whatever, Donicio. Secretaries. And it was given. It was delivered to the being that it was supposed to go to. Now, when I came back home, after that flight, I came back in LA, got off the airplane, and I said, well, I can either go from here, I can go back to Santa Barbara. You see, I had left my mom's house prior to going to Italy, prior to going to the Vatican and delivering this message. This message broke the entire church. This is what y'all really not understanding. Once this message was delivered, that entire structure collapsed. That meant that the collapse was there. It was imminent. I wrote this with my eyes closed and my hand was moving like this. That destroyed it. that destroyed the illusion. And so prior to this, though, I had just had my, 20-somethingth birthday. Once again, this is all a thing that don't even exist. I've become a new being. But I had just had my 25th birthday. And I had been living with my mom, you know, and I said, I can't do this anymore. I need to get out of here. So I just took a little bag and I started sleeping in parks. I just started sleeping outside. You know, I was homeless. I'll be living on the street and stuff like that for a period of time. And then that's when I went out to Italy, did that and came back. So when I came back, I said, well, I could go back to Santa Barbara or I could just do something else. So I was like, let me go to Hollywood. Why Hollywood? I don't know. But I went out there and I was preaching, not preaching in the sense of that, but, you know, letting the indigenous beings, letting all beings who are chosen know who they are. And I was sleeping on Hollywood Boulevard. You know, I was sleeping on Hollywood Boulevard, right on the star, right on the stars, you know, and I met an individual down there too, call him Soot. Soot is the original name for the black one, the black god. Called him R.S. Rich Soot. And, you know, we started seeing some things together. For example, I'm just telling these stories. We were wilding. I was getting drunk. I was smoking cigarettes. You know what I mean? The shit we were smoking on probably laced with something. You know what I mean? I don't even know. I was on. I didn't really care. I was drinking Four Locos. Smoking the menthols to the face. I didn't give a fuck. And we went up into the Rite Aid and just straight up took the bottles, boom, and walk right out. And it's two security guards. You know what Rich did? He said, get the fuck out the way or I'm going to tell him it's a motherfucking play. I'm going to tell them this whole thing is an illusion. That's how I started knowing and started seeing that this is all, everything around me. Life is a stage and we're all actors. Those are the words. Those are the words of Shakespeare. Life is a stage and we're all actors. He said, I'm going to tell him it's all a movie. Get out the fucking way. And them two security guards moved right out the way and we just walked right out. And we were drinking champagne. We was wilding. Smoking on the corner, on the block. I remember a dude pulled up, right? In a Escalade, trying to bump with his little snow bunny in the other side, white Escalade, and Soot had the roach, smoking the roach, and the dude tried to bump right next to us. He took the motherfucking roach and threw it. The window was rolled down, threw it in the car right into the Escalade, and dude just looked like, yo, this nigga's tripping. It peeled off. He didn't even say nothing. Didn't do nothing. And then he peeled off. You saw in the back of the car, it had the little rhinestones around the license plate. Like, that wasn't even his whip. He was just trying to flex. He threw the roach right in there. So, like I said, we were just wilding out. And, you know, some things occurred. And we was out of it. And so, like, what happened was, we were talking about going out to Vegas or whatever, doing some things out in Vegas. And that never ended up happening. That never ended up happening. Ended up in jail. And That was crazy. That was crazy. Once I went there, that's how a lot of changes happened. 340 days in solitary. I remember one time when I first went in, they're trying to get me to take my cuffs off. And they're like, get on. They took me in a room. I'm telling you, they took me in a room. They was like, get on your knees, we'll take the cuffs off. I told the man, suck my dick, fuck you, and get on my knees. So they said, get on your knees, when you take the cuffs off. I wouldn't get on my knees, you know what I mean? I always just been, I'm not gonna do certain stuff. It's just not gonna happen. You're gonna have to kill me, and I can't die. So you can't get me to do anything. You know? And so they brought in like 8 cops. And started hitting me off on the legs. And I started feeling this power inside of me, this strength. It started building up inside of me. It was just this strength, like super, superhuman strength. And they couldn't bring me down. So they started hitting me on the legs with the baton or whatever. And I just went down because I wasn't trying to go through all that. So I just kind of like allowed myself to go down. Now, I had on some shorts. This is when I first got booked. And I was holding on to the shorts, like holding them. They're trying to take my pants off. They're trying to take my pants off of me. And shit, my higher self only knows what was really trying to go down. You know what I mean? Because that they on some other shit. So why y'all trying to take my pants off? Holding on tight. And they said, stop resisting. You know what I mean? I know what they do. I know what these motherfuckers be doing to people like me. But they can't do that to the God. You know what I'm saying? They can't violate me. They can't. It's not possible. I'm too righteous. So I held on so tight that my fingernail ripped off and started just bleeding everywhere. They was twisting the back of my ankle to where it almost broke and had my knee just popped out like. And I was holding on and I just started speaking. I started speaking in tongues, calling on the ancestor. And all of a sudden, one of them said, stop, stop. The spirit says, stop. Listen, he says, stop, stop. The spirit says, stop. And about 10 seconds later, they all jumped up off of me, ran out. They uncuffed the cuffs, jumped off of me and ran out and slammed the door. He said, the spirit says, stop. This is what I'm telling y'all, always been protected. So when I was in there, you know, I was transferred over to the Twin Towers facility, which, you know, probably the worst county jail in the United States. And from a lot of the people I talked to, they said they'd rather be in prison than in the county jail. Prison is the easier life than that county jail. I was in that shit, you know, at first solitary, you know, because, they asked me who I was, you know, and I told them who I was. I am. That's it. I can't be relegated. I couldn't be relegated to an ego personality. You know, I am. I'm everything. So I was in the high observation housing unit and all that type of stuff. Because, you know. Oh, and they always wanted to take my blood and my DNA swabs. Wonder why. Now I know why. I know why, but you know, it's all good. So, during the course that I was in there, that's when I started really meditating and I started focusing my attention. I finally got a pencil and I'd draw the pencil, on one spot of the room. And I'd stare at that one spot for like hours and hours at a time. And then I finally started getting books sent to me from my mom. And there's only my only people that visited me in jail was my mom, my dad, my best friend, and my uncle one time. But they were all there for me. That's why they get everything. You know what I mean? So I went through a lot in there, and I started writing. That's where my book came from, Thoughts in Solitude. Thoughts in Solitude came out of that situation. And, you know, I wasn't allowed to even have a, you know, like simple stuff that turn you to an animal. At first, they took all my clothes, so I was in there naked on the 7th floor, and there was shit all over the wall. Shit all over the wall. Only hot water was coming out. Hot air was blowing out. Excuse me. Drinking out the sink. And then later I was sent down to the 5th floor where, you know, I didn't get enough. You can't have any utensils. I couldn't brush my teeth or take a shower. They wouldn't take me out. I don't even know if you can see this, but my back molar started falling out because I couldn't brush my teeth. And the food that I was eating, that's why I'm telling y'all, that's why I'm so heavy and I'm kicking everything, dealing with your diet and stuff like that, because like I'm trying to show you, I hope that you can see that. I hear. And the bottom teeth, they were starting to fall out. My hair was starting to fall out. I didn't get no sunlight for almost the lesser part of a year, 340 days to be exact. Couldn't have no utensils, so I'd be eating with my hands and really becoming an animal. Like that's some savage shit. And they'll make me lay down on my stomach to get my food. Lay down on my stomach and they'll throw my food through a hole and they throw it on the floor. And I had to get it up off the floor and eat it. A fluorescent light on top of my head and never turned off for 24 hours out of the day. You know, a whole lot of other things. Sometimes it would be, I wasn't able to get toilet paper. So there'll be brown paper bags. I'll have to wipe my ass with a brown paper bag sometime. They wouldn't take me out to take a shower for 6 months. Only time I ever came out of my cell was for these little 30-minute, once a week sometimes, my family and my mom or my dad would come and see me. And that was the only time I was able to come out of the cell. Other than that, for about almost six, 7 months, I stayed inside of that jail cell. Unless I had to go to, like, court, which they would take you and they'll shackle you up and put the shackles all around your waist and make sure that the entire time you were shackled up like this. You know, so that was real. But at the same time, I was able to get books. That was the one thing I was allowed. It took a long, long time for me to even get the pencil so I could write my Thoughts in Solitude book. You know, but, that's the story behind that. But, yeah, like, this is what's leading me to make this video, is that I was doing a meditation yesterday and I had a lot of these feelings start coming up. And so I feel like it's necessary to just talk about them for myself and get them out there, like, so that they can just be out, you know, because I'm a new being now, you know, and this is just dead energy that don't even exist any longer. But it's important that people can understand my journey. You know, they're not going to understand it, but at least that they can hear it. So, yeah. So, like, you know, sometimes, you know, drinking out the sink. Sometimes that water, the sink, I wouldn't be able to get no water. It would turn off. No water coming out. Yeah. Eating off the floor with your hands. There's a window like this. The window is one slit that's about this big, less than 2 inches, and a red line that go right through it, and it didn't look towards the sun, it looked the opposite direction, and it was like the window like that, that's it. And I try to look out, and all you'll see is like a big ass plant, like an energy plant or some shit, like, you know, some type of a plant outside. That was it, you know. Every 15 minutes they'll come through and check, look at you like an animal, you know, and walk by, you know. And at nighttime, come through with a flashlight every 15 minutes, shine the flashlight in your little cell. You know, so to experience that, I'm telling you this. The individual that was next to me, there was somebody that was next to me, in a cell next to me, trying to hang himself from the light fixture. Tried to drown himself in the toilet. Like, these are the type of things that I was seeing and experiencing. Another individual just was smearing shit all over his cell, just shit everywhere. Putting on his face and his skin, like, dealing with that, you know. So to be around that type of energy and to still maintain and to still rise, that's symbolic right there of the thousand petal lotus. And it was in that circumstance and in that environment that I meditated so deeply. I actually filled out a form, and I had a Buddhist woman come, and she'll come and speak to me once a week and give me books and give me more information. That's how I told you I studied that. I also would have my mom sending me close to 3 or 4 books per week. So like I told you, now I don't read anymore. I get my information and downloads direct from source, because I am the source. Listen, this body, this vessel, this consciousness came from what's behind that sun. It came from cosmic matter. It fell. I'm comprised of stardust. You know what I'm saying? So I no longer need to go through those avenues. But, you know, that was part of it. That was part of the growth. And so I'll be reading close to three to five books a week with ease. I'll stay up all night just reading. I'm talking about big boys too. 300-400 page books on all subjects. And so that's why people ask, where'd you get all this knowledge and stuff? It's been, you know, I've been put in positions where I've been removed from the general populace so that I can get space to self to grow. So, you know, the way I look at it, it was like that period of time was like a ashram, a spiritual place. But you see, these beings that are living up in caves and stuff, they're not in tumultuous environments like that. You see, so my mind had to be extra strong. My mind had to be extra strong. And that's where I started creating my realities. You know, the reality that you now see me living. You know, this shit don't come, it doesn't come easy. Look at the story of Chinese bamboo. Once that Chinese farmer, he plants his bamboo, it take about 7 years. 5 years, I believe. 5 years to come into fruition, because that whole time everybody else is planting their little seeds and their plants are growing. They grow, they have their time, and they fall. This Chinese bamboo, you plant it in the ground, it's got to establish roots so deep, so strong the roots have to be. And you got to water it every day, you got to keep continuing, but nothing's going to pop out of the ground for 5 years. Within 6 weeks, it's going to grow like 50 feet in the sky. It's not that it wasn't growing the whole time. It's that the roots were going down into the earth to prepare for the true growth that was about to come. That is my story. The growth that I have seen to come overnight, it didn't come overnight. That's what you must realize. Like, this was planned. Look. I want y'all to see this, because I never show this. I gotta get this in the light so you can see it. This was planned.
I don't know if you could see that. But whether or not you can, it don't even matter. It says already written. Like I said, this destiny, this is my life. And it was already written. Preordained. From before I even came down here. You know what I'm saying? Who does this? Who can do this? But you know, that experience in and of itself, reading, I read so many books. Like, I'm talking about, I literally had a library set up. I was giving out so many books to other people and helping to raise consciousness, because the most intelligent beings are the ones that are in that system. I'm telling you straight up, those are the ones that are the most intelligent. You know, and I may end up getting a cut at some time, you know. But you see, I haven't cut this because this, I haven't cut my hair since I left the that experience. That's hell. That was hell. That was my last step. That was my last step into coming into my godhood. You see, when that spirit came and talked to me in 5/30/2010, that was nearly 7 years ago. We dealing with the seven. That's going to be that perfected God number. You see what I'm saying? That's why I'm coming into. That's why I'm making this video right now. But, yeah. If it would have told me, that's why it told me, like, I'm going to use you for something powerful and something special. You see, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, wasn't always Malcolm X. He wasn't always Elhaj Malik Shabazz. He was Malcolm Little. He was a pimp. He was a drug dealer. He was sticking motherfuckers up. Without doing that, he would have never been able to make that transition into the God that he was, the God that he is. You see? So, it's all part of the story. It's all part of the big plan. You know, so. Long story short, I was removed from that situation. All charges dismissed. And I've been out for about 6-7 months now. And I've been doing constant growth, constant spiritual elevation. And I have finally reached the state to where I can say that I am. That I am. And my story is only beginning. God's son.